Quest Audiobooks presents an unabridged recording of Make Them Pay by Mike Grist, narrated by Jeff Harding. Chapter 1. Dead Horse. Chris Wren sat in his truck in Dead Horse, Alaska, looking out at the thick drifts of snow. It was cold, even with the AC pumping out heat, and dark but for the glimmering green tendrils of the northern lights above. He was planning his next kill. Pythagoras. On the Blue Fairy's dark internet of abusers, he was one of the worst, active since the beginning. His track record was phenomenal, with hundreds of children destroyed in his wake. Maybe he would have some answers. Wren rubbed his bleary eyes. He was worn out, hadn't been sleeping well recently. His hand shook like an alcoholic's coming down, smeared with blood still. Whose blood? He couldn't remember. The last 3 months were a blur of Blue Fairy interrogations. He'd been in Florida for one, then California, then New Mexico, hunting the Pinocchios who'd targeted his children, who might know something about his father. Apex of the pyramid death cult, the man who'd ruined Wren's young life and even now hung over his children's lives like some sword of Damocles. His phone started buzzing in the glove box. Wren ignored it, watching the rippling green aurora as it danced across the deep Arctic sky. It was almost painfully beautiful. So much beauty in such a dark place. 1 a.m. The sun had gone down a few months earlier and wasn't coming up again for a few months more. The company town of Dead Horse on the northwest coast of Alaska in mid-January, a place for oil field workers, ice road truckers, the occasional coach full of Japanese tourists, and now Christopher Wren. He'd pulled up 5 hours earlier after a long-haul drive up from the States, shown his fake passport and special permit at the town limits. The guard had been chatty, said he was the only tourist in town this deep into the winter, boasting that the rivers were so frozen even the fish were hibernating. Wren hadn't known if that was a joke or not. The phone kept on vibrating. Wren popped the glove box and picked it up, a burner bought a few weeks ago. He thumbed the screen and the vibration stopped. An alarm, the same time he'd set night after night. He tapped in the phone number on the glass for the 100th time and stared at it. 4 a.m. here, 7 a.m. back east in the Delaware duplex, where his wife Lorelei would just be waking up, laying out her yoga mat for a morning routine. Their kids, Jake and Quinn, would be asleep still. Almost as if nothing had changed. Except everything had changed. They weren't in their family home in New York anymore. His wife and kids had fled when Lorelei found out what Wren did for a living. The CIA's international assassin of cults, gangs, and cartels. Saint Justice, they called him. Already, Lorelei had found a new man. She didn't want Wren's protection, despite or perhaps because of the threat he brought to hang over their heads. She didn't even want to let him see his kids, at least not until the threat had passed. Until Wren found his father and put him down like a rabid dog. So Wren was out here, hunting leads. He squeezed the delete key and the Delaware phone number disappeared, just like every night before. To see his kids again, he first had to make them safe, and that path led right through Pythagoras. A top-level Pinocchio in the Blue Fairy organization. One of the founding members, even, Wren's interrogations so far had unearthed. If anyone had the link back to Wren's father, it was this man. Wren reached into the back seat of the truck, began pulling on his cold weather gear. Thick boots, a Toiron fiber bulletproof vest under a heavy red parka, a big toboggan hat, goose down gloves. In the belly flap of the parka, he put his Sig Sauer P320-45 ACP, then opened the truck door and stepped out. Freezing air blasted his face, Fresh snowfall crunched under his feet. He stood for a moment, taking in the green-tinted scene. To the south lay snow-coated mountains like shaved ice confections, sauced with thick veins of meltwater. To the north lay the empty expanse of the gray Arctic Ocean. The sky above was a dappled wash of aurora, and beneath it lay Dead Horse, just a cluster of boxy modular structures constructed atop gravel pads staked into the tundra bog. Wren strode forward. The supply depot lay at the rough center of town, a few hundred yards past an iced-over lake. Industrial structures hugged the road as if for warmth. A mechanics yard, a field of towering electrical transformers, a heavy vehicles pool. A few people were out early. A guy scraping ice off the windshield of his pickup in rough, raspy strokes. Drunk pipeline workers heading back to their company lodgings, all bundled up in bright jackets. It was a dry county, but the locals always had their ways to source booze. The air smelled impossibly fresh and stung his throat. A few cars lined the road, big country trucks with all-wheel drive and snow chains. The depot was a blue box in their midst, airdropped into position on a corner overlooking the lake. 24 hours, the sign said. Company workers sending scripts down the Pan American Highway back home. Requests for miscrated booze, moonshine stills, letters from loved ones, and laptops. Wren had a lead on one particular laptop. Its precise address encrypted 6 ways from Sunday and unreadable, but the metadata remained. It had last been used by Pythagoras to access the Blue Fairy's dark internet. He'd been online and watching the feed when Wren tore down Pleasure Island. Records showed the IP address was routed through the central company hub, offering no better geographic location than the whole of Dead Horse. Standing population of 50, transient workers hitting 3,000. Time to whittle that down. Chapter 2. Depot. The depot's doors swung open smoothly, revealing a 10x8 waiting space with a few rows of plastic seats, a black vinyl floor puddled with meltwater, a desk running from wall to wall and shielded with glass. Beyond the glass lay the dark warehouse, crates, boxes, shelves stacked with consumables, machinery, tech. Easily 400 square feet. Plenty of space to smuggle booze, cigars, an illegal chipset. The clerk behind the glass was in his 60s, grizzled and hard-bitten with deep crevasse wrinkles and a wind-whipped face, buzz-cut gray hair, and a heavy black raincoat. A rig worker or pipeline man too broken to brave the ice anymore, Wren figured. His breath made puffs of steam in the cold air as he stared ahead. "Good morning," Wren said brightly. "It's midnight," the guy answered flatly. "You're the tourist. What do you want?" Wren smiled. He knew tourist names were listed on a town-wide bulletin. Permits were required for the whole area, too close to the Alaskan pipeline for unsecured access. "I'm here for the natural beauty," he said, striding over. The guy's ice didn't crack. "This is the only place open. Which do you recommend for sightseeing, midnight sun or northern lights?" The guy frowned. "Aurora's burning outside right now, last I checked. Nothing to see in here." "But there are other kinds of beauty," Wren allowed, and let a beat pass. "I heard you take special deliveries." The guy gave him a long, bored look, then held up one hand and started counting off fingers, like this was a checklist he'd long ago tired of repeating. "We don't run hookers, we don't smuggle, we don't traffic. This is a depot for company men. Shampoo, toothpaste, luxuries. Whatever you heard otherwise is wrong." Wren let that slide off him. He'd run contraband through similar frontier depots for years. He knew the temptations men on the fringes faced, each a point of leverage. What about computers? The guy didn't blink. You want a computer at midnight? Go on to the Best Buy over in Prudhoe Bay. Better rates. They open at 9. Wren smiled and leaned in. Prudhoe Bay's smaller than Dead Horse. There's no Best Buy. Besides, this is a custom order. A laptop with powerful encryption capacity. Wren let that hang for a moment. I have a referral. The guy's eyes narrowed. Like I said, we don't smuggle women, drugs, or computers. I don't care about your referral. Go out and look at the sky, son, before you get in trouble. That wasn't enough for Wren. There was something familiar in the guy's eyes. Smugness, maybe. Maybe fear. This particular laptop's not illegal. Not in itself, anyway. Cryptographic software baked onto the board. I hear it's nearly undetectable. I also heard you took delivery of one 7 months back. My friend said I could get another here. The guy stared. What friend? Wren smiled, pulled off his gloves and set them on the counter, then pulled out his wallet. It was fat with bills. He fanned through them. Pull a record of receipt. You tell me. That's all I want. Then I'm gone. No mention of the whiskey crates I saw down the side. It's a dry county, last I heard. That's one count in the smuggling column. So get out your books, slide a finger down. 500 says it never happened. He eased the bills out of his wallet, laid them on the counter. 500. A week's work, maybe. Consider it overtime. He pushed them closer. There's blood on your hands, the old guy said. It didn't seem to faze him. Wren noticed it too. It's not mine, he answered, like that made it all right. A long moment passed. Wren's breath steamed the glass. One more corrupt official to bribe, or threaten, or whatever it took, and he was already thinking ahead to his plan for Pythagoras. Active for decades, with dozens of children destroyed in his wake. The guy would talk. He could feel it. The link back to his father was achingly close. The route back to seeing his kids. Then he heard a siren. It was far off, but growing closer. More than one. He refocused. The smug glint in the old guy's eyes had come to the fore now. When had that change happened? Wren cursed silently. He'd let himself get distracted by the big picture. You hit the panic button, Wren said, under the counter. Company security, the old guy answered, offering the slightest shrug. Montanan accent, maybe? Wren wondered, moderated by long years away. It took all sorts to populate a pipeline station. Loners, largely, men drawn to the verges of society, to the allure of the maddening wild. The sirens drew in. Wren didn't react. Didn't run. I can give you the order number, he said, smiling now like it was funny. I have the signature of the receiving agent, one William Hartwright. Would that be you? Man before me. Care to show me some ID? The guy almost cracked a smile. Wouldn't care to, friend, but you'll be needing yours. Last fella came in asking about shipments. He left with 2 rounds in his chest and a bag over his head. Helicopter, FBI letterman, the full contingent. We shoot first out here. Terrorism demands it this close to the pipehead. Tourists come on our good graces, and you just blew right through. I made threats? Wren asked. You'll testify at my trial? It'll be a write-in. The guy let his smile through now, feeling his own power reaching out. This was what happened when you asked about laptops and dead horse.
And if you're carrying a weapon, like the pistol weighing down your belly pouch on federal land like this, that's a straight-up terror charge. 10 to 15 years in solitary if they don't shoot you outright.
Wren nodded, thinking through his position. The FBI threat was empty, at least in the short term. There wasn't a field station any closer than Anchorage, which was a 2-hour flight away. Maybe the local cops, enough to secure a remote pipehead and keep 3,000 rowdy pipe workers in line, but that'd be a handful only, 10 at the most, say 3 or 4 on duty at any one time. It didn't worry Wren overly. On the other side of it, this guy had punched the alarm button to call them out. On the strength of what? A couple of insistent questions and some old blood on his hand? Something else was going on here, and Wren decided to lay his cards on the table. The laptop guy, how much is he paying you? The old guy smiled, showing his hand too. More than you can afford. That was a tell, and it made things easier. This guy knew about Pythagoras. He was loyal to Pythagoras. The sound of sirens wafted in like a bugle call, growing louder.
Usually they run now, the clerk observed. Nowhere to run, Wren answered. We both know that. Not for me, not for you.
The guy frowned. Wren almost laughed. Sometimes he felt sorry for the people who crossed his path. What is he, Pythagoras? A foreman on the pipeline? Maybe a director of the company? The guy leered at the name.
I wouldn't worry about him. Think about yourself, son. Get your story straight. Explain that blood to the feds.
That was all the confirmation he needed. The guy knew who Pythagoras was, and that meant only one thing. He was in the Blue Fairy, too. Wren felt the world flip around him as permission was granted. It always felt like that, when a civilian became a target.
Explaining the blood's easy. I've been killing my way across America.
He said it flat, knew from experience it would come off intimidating.
Pinocchio's, like the man you're protecting.
A flicker of annoyance.
You saw the Blue Fairy live stream off Pleasure Island, I'm thinking.
That means you saw me, Christopher Wren, by the altar, shackling in one of your boys. The guy paled noticeably. His eyes widened.
Wait, what?
Now it was Wren's turn to grin.
I look different in real life, right? Ever since then, I've been cleaning up the mess.
He placed both his stained hands palm up on the counter.
Maybe this was from Des Moines or Cincinnati. I thought I washed all the blood off, but it sticks, you know? It gets in the grain.
I drove straight north afterward, slept in the car, 3 days driving just to see you, William Hartwright.
That's you, right?
You've got what I want.
Give me Pythagoras, maybe you get off easy.
A man like me, Hartwright.
You sure you want to go hard?
The guy blanched a little, but forced a laugh.
Bullshit. You ain't him.
Him, the boogeyman who brought the Blue Fairy down.
Let's find out. Your toy town cops will be here soon. No way you've got FBI lettermen on standby. And maybe they'll try to bag me.
He reached into the belly flap of his jacket and pulled out the Sig 45, laid it on the counter. Hartwright's eyes flashed to the door. The sirens were getting real close. Coming around the lake, not far to go. Maybe on snowmobiles, blue lights flashing. Wren would like to see that.
The glass is bulletproof, Hartwright said.
Wren snorted.
Not against hollow point bullets. 3 shots and I'm through. Then the 4th finds your heart. Probably you should run. He pointed back into the warehouse. You've got two exits plus the loading bays back there. But what if they don't open? Those locks are easy to jam with a heating filament. You can do it with an industrial light bulb in seconds. And who's to say I didn't? He paused, charting the guy's sharpening breath. A bluff, but the guy wouldn't know that. Now you're really thinking. What kind of crazy fish you hooked? Hartwright, you don't want this. Roll belly up now, and I'll let the feds have you. Otherwise, you're dealing with me, and I'm not that big on forgiveness. Hartwright gulped, took a step back. Wren could almost see the thoughts flying in his head. Too much to take in, narrowing reality down to an immediate calculation. It had been a normal, quiet night in Dead Horse, and now everything had changed. Things were life and death, and who was ready for that kind of decision? Wren always tried to make the math easy for perps and tossed his wallet on the counter, like lead on the scale. The sirens sounded to be right outside. Take it all. Must be 3,000 in there. Give me what I want. I'll give you a day's head start before I call you in. Hartwright wilted like an orchid under studio lights. Events were compounding and jamming him up. Wren fixed him with a steady gaze. It was all in the pitch, all in the delivery. One of the sirens bleeped and cut out at the door. Your call, Wren said. Either way, I'm getting what I want. But how angry do you think I'll be if I have to kill these guys? Their blood'll be on your hands. Pretty soon after, yours will be on mine. You won't like that. Footfalls on the steps outside. It's on your word now. You push the button. Better decide. Wren slipped the gun back into his belly flap as the door opened. Chapter 3. Toy Town Cops. A kick. The door swung wide, and a gun came in first, left hand clamped underneath, finger already squeezed to the trigger. Two in the doorway, a young white guy in front and a black older guy in back, both wearing Navy security outfits with golden badges. Company cops. I need you on your knees right now, sir, with your hands up, said the lead guy. 25 at a push, with rough stubble, swollen shoulders, and a rounded back from unbalanced powerlifting. He shuffled in through a meltwater puddle, making room for his colleague. Mid-50s, maybe a family up here. This is all an accident, Wren said. Right, Mr. Hartwright? The cops looked to Hartwright and back. It's him, Hartwright said, his tone dead cold. Wren glanced over his shoulder and saw Hartwright was now holding a gun. Christopher Wren, the guy who brought down the ferry. That was unexpected. Wren turned back. The lead cop's eyes immediately flared wide, and now his knuckle bruised white, riding the trigger hard. So they all knew him. In a second, the world flipped once more, changing Wren's calculations. These weren't just Toy Town cops anymore responding to an alarm. He'd stumbled upon a Pinocchio nest.
He's what?
The cop in back asked.
The guy from Pleasure Island, Hartwright went on. I didn't recognize him at first, but he says he's been killing Pinocchios up and down the country. Bastard boasted he's got their blood on his hands.
This revelation stunned the room further. The older cop kicked the door closed behind him, gun beaded now on Wren's face, too.
Fellas, Wren said with a slight nod, I didn't recognize you without your masks.
You sure?
The older cop asked. The young one's brows beetled hard together, and his lips curdled to a sneer. Maybe Wren had killed some of his idols.
It's me, Wren confirmed. And you're all screwed.
This made for another odd moment,
Wren stood with three guns pointing at his face, making threats.
It's a bluff, Hartwright said in back, empowered by the layer of glass between them. He's alone, here under a fake name. He's got a Sig 45 in his belly flap, but that's it.
That's not it, Wren said, keeping it cool and calm. The lead cop made a step forward. His face had turned blotchy red like a parboiled sausage. I have got a Sig, but I'm not going for it as long as we all go easy.
The guy blurted a laugh and stabbed with the gun. Easy. Wait until Pythagoras gets here. The things you did, you mother—
Be quiet, Wren snapped. And strangely, the cop did. They all did. Afraid of his reputation, maybe. He worked the angle swiftly. If you want to live through this, you need to stay calm and think before this depot becomes another oil lake crater in the ice. You take me out and fire rains down from the skies like a biblical plague. I've got two MQ-1 Predator drones circling at 20,000 feet. It'll be a minute or so before their missiles hit. You think you can clear the blast radius before that happens?
He eyed the men. Didn't matter that there were no drones. It was a cozy fallback bluff he'd used many times before. Deliver it confidently enough, it gave everyone pause. It helped that plenty of times it hadn't been a bluff.
Maybe not, and we're all pink mist. This block becomes a crater, Dead Horse's latest dark tourist attraction.
Silence. The front guy licked his trembling lips, eyes darting to Hartwright.
Bullshit, he's bluffing.
We're in a hostage situation now, Wren went on, whether you like it or not. I want Pythagoras, you want to survive the day. I could be convinced to let you go if you give him up easy.
He paused on that a second.
Well, not go. Like I said to Hartwright here, I'll give you a day before I call down the FBI. I think my boy here would like that. He nodded at the lead cop. Am I right?
Like it, the guy blurted.
His eyes burned with rage. Wren figured pushing him to the limit was his next move. Get him hot enough to break the logjam, and smiled as patronizingly as he could.
I'm gonna tear your damn head off.
Figures, Wren said dismissively, and looked to the older cop and back. Get this joker out of here. He's gonna get you all killed.
We need to see the proof you've got the drones,
the guy in back replied. Wren gave a short, sharp laugh.
I'm proof. The fact that I'm here. So get him out. He's a liability. Then we talk.
Simon, said Hartwright behind the glass to Wren's left. A cautionary voice now, telling a kid to calm down and put his toys away. To let the adults deal.
Take it easy, okay?
Now he knows my name,
the young guy hissed, winding himself up like a pressure cooker, ready to pop.
He doesn't just walk away from this, not on some bullshit threat he can't even back up.
Wren eyed him head on. You gonna be the hero, son? Die for your right to wear the Pinocchio mask, is that it? And take all these fine gentlemen with you?
You don't know what we've done here, the things we've built.
Are you serious? Wren snapped, winding him up tighter. The things you've built? I pulled Pleasure Island down in an hour. Whatever two-bit BS you've propped up here is just sad. It makes me sick how pathetic your infrastructure is. Look where I am, one step away from your leader on my first try. A crypto laptop sourced through the depot with records on the net for all to see. You're all children here playing at being big men.
The young cop's hand trembled with adrenaline, more humiliation than he could bear.
Don't listen to him, Simon, pleaded the cop in back. He couldn't understand.
Children, Simon shouted like an eruption.
You don't know a damn thing.
I know cowards when I see them, Wren said, getting louder. You'll squeal and roll over like every other Pinocchio on that ship when the moment comes. At least they were ambitious, but what are you here? Lice under the rock I just flipped over, belly up and begging to be stomped.
I think. Don't listen to him, Hartwright called, but Wren had a head of steam going now. I think secretly you're terrified, all you mask-wearing man-children, the biggest cucks of the darknet, so frail you can't face anything but a child. I'll show you what it means to be a man, Simon. Simon flipped, eyes so wide open they were white all the way around. He forgot about Wren's drones and any sense of his own superior position, and fired. Chapter 4. Simon. Wren was already moving. A single sharp step to the right blocked the line of fire from the cop and back and saw Simon's first shot hit the glass where he'd been standing. The impact came with a sharp crump, chased by the resounding blast of the cordite discharge. His second shot zipped wide to Wren's right. Young muscles bathed in corticosteroids overcompensated wildly, not expecting Wren to stop moving so sharply. 2 seconds gone, long enough for Wren's right hand to find the SIG 45 in his belly flap. Without pulling it out, he fired 3 muffled blasts directly through the fabric and into Simon. Every one hit. Simon's body jerked with each impact, his own bullets spraying wildly. The cop in back staggered as one of Wren's 45 caliber hollow points punched straight through into his chest. He squeezed off one shot that Simon took in the back, then they both dropped. Double thuds. 10 seconds or less. A silent second passed, echoes ringing around the small box and out into the Arctic wastes. Simon breathed his last, muttering words into a dirty meltwater puddle. The cop in back dropped to his knees like he was in slow motion, wheezing hard, gun forgotten, both hands to his chest. He wouldn't last much longer. Wren turned to Hartwright, unhurried, like he had all the time in the world. Hartwright was holding a gun up to the glass, a black metal Colt Python with a walnut stock, Magnum 357 caliber. Cool looking, but not nearly as much bang as Wren's SIG 45. His crevassed face was white. A second passed, then he started firing. White starbursts broke across the plate glass, each chased by another sharp crump. Bulletproof glass. Hartwright emptied his cylinder. 6 shots. The thunder of the blasts filled the warehouse and echoed back in tidal waves of sound until there was just the clicking of the hammer on metal. The glass was a spiderweb pattern of fractures. Hartwright was barely visible through the sharp-cut lines of white, his once smug eyes gone wide. Wren knew exactly what he was feeling. Red tunneled vision, pounding heart, hyperventilation, diffused thoughts, time dilation. Everything Simon had just felt. The mind could be a weapon, turning people's own bodies against them. "I bet you wish you'd taken the money now," Wren said.
I
began the older man, but he had nothing left to say. His rational mind had deserted him in the throes of the strongest fight-or-flight reaction he'd ever felt.
"You messed up," Wren said companionably.
"But let's be honest. The mistake wasn't today. Maybe it dates back 60 years to the day you were born. So it's not even really your fault. Maybe it was the day you met Pythagoras. Nature or nurture, Hartwright, and I don't really care. I've heard all the sob stories. You've seen what I am and what I mean. No excuses stand up to that. Tell me what I want to know, and maybe you get to go to jail. There's no other option here." Hartwright jawed at the air, looking for an avenue to argue his way out of. 10 minutes ago, his life was normal. Good, maybe. "Where's Pythagoras?" Wren asked.
"He shot you," Hartwright insisted, paling further.
"He missed," Wren answered. "Now decide." Hartwright's eyes flickered. Then he ran. Wren didn't wait to see if the back doors would open. He knew they would. The heating filament story was all part of his bluff.
Instead, he strode through the main door and looked out over Dead Horse and Colleen Lake. The cold air was bracing on his ungloved hands. The cig instantly absorbed the cold and bit into his palm. He put it back in the torn belly flap. The lake stretched on forever. It looked like fresh snow was in the offing. Out here, you wouldn't know. A deep breath brought a sharp pain in his lungs, so cold it hurt. He listened out and heard the slam of the rear door go, then advanced down to the snow-coated road, where one patrol car, a sedan with its blue lights still spinning, and a snowmobile with lights of its own were waiting. No other blue lights spun up across the little town. Maybe just two guys on duty at a time. Someone might place an emergency call, muster them out, but Wren figured he had time. He took the snowmobile and caught up to Hartwright in 30 seconds. The machine ate up the distance, the snow making every surface navigable, off the road, over the sidewalk, up a low embankment. Around the back of the depot he went, down a fence encircling a heavy vehicles pool, where he ran down the older man beside a heaped pile of glinting gray sand. He hit Hartwright with the snowmobile's nose, enough to send him reeling, killed the engine, and dismounted. Hartwright scrabbled at the snow, crazed now and babbling like them all, desperate to survive.
"Please, listen. I can help you. I'll tell you whatever you want to know."
Wren already knew that. He had just one question. And it didn't take long to get the answer. Chapter 5. Lockbox. Wren retrieved his gloves. The depot was a wreck. He went in through the back door, wrote up a sign, and duct taped it to the front. Decent behavior. But it wasn't like it mattered much. There were no kids up here to stumble on such a horrific scene. At least no kids that were stumbling around free. Wren pulled on a pair of heavy-duty goggles, maybe Simon's. He killed the blue lights on the patrol car and listened, but still no other sirens were inbound. Why should there be? A couple of gunshots wouldn't be that unusual up here. This was true wilderness, and hungry Arctic foxes or polar bears wouldn't respect the Dead Horse permit system in their search for food. As for the two dead cops in the depot, Wren guessed he'd exhausted the local PD's graveyard shift. Maybe there was no one left to come until the dawn changeover revealed Simon and his friend were out of commission. That should give him hours of clearance yet. But in that time, he had to find Pythagoras, extract the information he needed, then get back and out a Dead Horse before hard security walls shut the airport down. The snowmobile revved, and he gave it its head. According to Hartwright, Pythagoras was a global shipping magnate tangentially involved in the pipeline, a Thai national named Somchai Thierovit. A multimillionaire, he had secretly retired 3 years back onto a 1,000-acre property 20 miles west of Dead Horse, hunkered in a 50-room mansion that was part research station, part hotel, part torture garden. Nobody knew he was up there, officially. There were no records. Exactly the kind of man his father would look to recruit. Wren gunned the throttle off the road at the edge of Dead Horse, beyond which lay only scrub and tundra. No roads, no routes, only access via boat, helicopter, and snowmobile. It seemed a joke that a shipping magnate had been undone by such a simple thing as a laptop imported up the Pan American Highway. But everybody makes mistakes under stress. Icy tundra flew by, interspersed by the vacant eyes of oil lakes and patches of thaw showing dark wet sedge and gray tundra moss, past old cement foundation blocks spraying abandoned pipes upward. Tattered shrubs broke ground cover in places studded with withered red winter berries. Pythagoras. 30 minutes ripped by in Arctic winds and powder spray. It began to snow, and the route ahead quickly fogged. Any sign of the lakes, the tundra, the vegetation faded under a fresh blanket of white. His goggles crusted over. West 290 degrees, Hartwright had said. 20 miles out. When the complex appeared, it came fast out of the heavy snow. 3 blocky mesas of concrete hollowed out by dark windows, like a giant wind chime laid flat. Apparently, the design had won awards for its architect, shipped out here in secret along with a construction crew. Hartwright had turned out to be as chatty as the guard at the Dead Horse town limits. At the end, Wren pulled past a helicopter on its pad, onto the faint outline of a long drive leading up to the raw cement structure. To the right lay a large crane-equipped jetty, with the Arctic Ocean flat and gray beyond. No boats, but one hell of a view. Was Somchai even here? Hartwright said he hadn't seen him for days. Wren killed the snowmobile's engine and stood, studying the building's facade. It was impressive. 3 floors of stacked cement boxes that were heavy and brutalist, but also somehow graceful, with large floor-to-ceiling windows revealing dark inner depths. He didn't want to imagine the secret cruelties hidden within those walls. He strode closer. The front door was sunken below ground level and heavily reinforced, controlled by an electronic lock. The garage was sunken too, with blast shields that opened side to side. No way to crack that short of a C4 cocktail. He circled the compound on the snowmobile. No pipes affixed to the exterior, no visible vents, no back door, no route to the roof. By now, he'd almost certainly been spotted on a dozen heat and movement cameras. Somchai had to know he was here, maybe busy destroying the evidence, which meant children could be dying right now. Wren had to get in, fast. Part of him longed for a semi-truck to smash into the building. But there was nothing like that. Maybe he could shoot out some of the windows, though they were all too high to reach, and the concrete walls were sheer and unclimbable. He pulled out his SIG 45 to test the theory anyway. The nearest window was 10 feet up. He trained in and fired, a full mag's worth of 7 bullets with one in the chamber. 8 plinking ricochets chased 8 45 cal booms. The snow deadened the echo, leaving Wren with his ears ringing, looking up at the window. Unmarked. Maybe a couple of divots bitten through the outer polycarbonate layer. He laughed. Triple layer plate glass, no doubt. Incredible for insulation out here. And helpfully bulletproof, even against his hollow point rounds. Wren looked around the concrete and barren snow. An idea came to him, but it was crazy. Still, what choice was there now? He could hardly lay siege to the place for weeks until Somchai gave out. The helicopter. It was probably a vanity exercise on Somchai's part, another display of conspicuous wealth, something to enjoy looking at out of his window. Still, the impact force on a helicopter rotor blade had to massively outrank the percussive inertia of his hollow point rounds. Crazy, but possible. Wren ran the snowmobile over to the pad. The helicopter was a Druve Advanced Light, one of the fastest single-rotor civilian vehicles in existence, worth some $5 million and capable of hauling 2,000 pounds of gear. Wren climbed up the side and tried the door. Locked. He smashed through the cockpit side glass with the SIG 45 and jiggled the door controls until the cab opened. The key for the electrical system was in a slot between the seats, likely standard procedure out here where helicopter thieves were few and far between. Wren turned it and the dash lit up. Bingo. It had been years since he'd flown a helicopter. Unlike riding a bike, it was a skill you could easily lose. He'd never flown a Druve to boot, but that was okay. The maneuver he was about to try wasn't on any training scheme he'd ever seen anyway. His pulse flashed at him from the smartwatch, pushing 80. Anytime kids were on the line.
He looked over the controls, took the cyclic, set his feet on the anti-torque pedals, and pushed the engine start. The rotors engaged and spun up fast, straightening out and chopping the falling snow into a downward cyclone that frothed like whipped cream off the pad. He cycled it up, and the machine lifted hard, bucking wildly in the wind. Wren adjusted the cyclic, sweat beating on his forehead, trying to control the machine before it splattered him across the pad. Takeoff and landing were always the hardest parts when dealing with the backwash of your own downdraft. It was only going to get harder. Finally stable, he turned the machine toward the house. Ramming speed could be fun, but there was little chance he'd be able to jump clear safely. No. Instead, he approached slowly, winging the finer controls and working calculations. The rotational diameter of the blades was about 40 feet. That was the kind of thing he could judge by eye. Hit solid reinforced cement and the blades would snap. The bird would roll, crash, and if he didn't burn up in the resulting fireball, he'd get chopped to pieces as he tried to flee it. He'd just have to avoid hitting cement. He hovered in low over the snow-covered gardens. Here a statue, there the replica of a Japanese pagoda. He brought the helicopter up to the top floor of the three-stack concrete boxes to the biggest floor-to-ceiling window overlooking the Arctic Ocean. Through the tinted glass, he picked out a richly appointed office, a stately desk, shelves stacked with leather-bound books, tall ficus plants framing the window. The helicopter roared in a sound chamber of its own making, the echo of its rotors bouncing back off the glass. He pulled in close, the edge of his rotor blades only yards from the window. Snow whipped madly down, then up, caught in complex crosswinds dictated by the angular shape of the building. Wren bit his lip and edged closer still. It would be tight, the turning circle of the blades versus the width of the window. No time to play patty cake. He worked the cyclic, and the helicopter jogged left, hovering within inches, leaning in until... The blades struck the window and screamed and spun, and glass crashed and sheared, and metal whined, and the whole machine juddered away, blades rattling madly. Wren fought for control as the Druve reeled, hit auto-rotation after 30 seconds of heart-stopping battle, then peered through whirling snow at the window. There was an ugly gouge where the tips of his rotors had smashed clear through the glass. But only a gouge. Shatterproof triple-layer glass backed with polycarbonate, he figured, as if he'd raked a serrated knife down a pat of cold butter. All he'd done was leave a scar. He laughed out loud. Imagine trying to work the Druve on another horizontal and two more verticals to cut out a square. It wouldn't be possible. Better to go with what already worked, now the first cut had been made. He edged in close again, pulled the SIG 45, aimed near the gouge at an angle that wouldn't see ricochets bouncing right back at him, and fired. 8 bullets drained the mag, each impact shredding the gouge wider and deeper, as if he was swinging a 10-pound hammer into a concrete wall, until at last the window hit some tensile inflection point. Glass screamed, metal crashed, and the whole shatterproof array finally gave out, calving into 3 great plates which toppled inward, thumping down hard on the fine Persian rug. The Druve bucked and whined in the snow. Likely he'd warped the blades and done permanent damage to the transmission knuckle with that stunt, and every second in the air moved it closer to a fatal malfunction. He steered sideways as close as he dared, then let the machine coast into auto-rotation, even as he kicked open the passenger door and flung himself through. The downdraft flattened him hard across the gap to land half in and half out of the building, chest on the toppled pane of glass and legs dangling. He kicked and slid, scrabbled for purchase, and managed to pull himself in as the Druve rotated away, blown back by its own backdraft with no hand at the cyclic. Wren rolled to the side. The Druve rolled like a leaping whale,
lost purchase on the air as it toppled, then slammed to its side on the snowy ground with a clattering shriek. The rotor blades tore themselves away in the frozen soil, and the transmission knuckle screamed. For a few seconds, the whole machine danced like a jitterbug. Wren tucked in tight at the side of the office with snow whipping in around him, waiting for the blast he knew would come. But none did. The engine just whined down to silence. He stood up and retrieved the SIG 45 from his belly flap. Chapter 6. Somchai. Wren kicked open the office door, SIG 45 locked in a two-hand grip. A corridor walkway led away, strung above a steep drop to a grand lobby below, all winter lit by the white tinge of Arctic sun. Teak flooring, Persian rugs, and chrome railings stretched along the walkway for 10 yards. A stunning modernist chandelier hung to his right, 5 tiers deep, made with the life-size alabaster casts of cherub-like children. He looked down to the lobby below. It was minimalist, massive, and open plan, with a sunken den and sofas, a dining table, and a kitchen bar. The air was warm, climate controlled, despite the gale whipping snow in behind him. No sign of Somchai. Wren advanced along the wall.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.